Before we get started, join me in our salvation prayer. Say it out loud. Heavenly Father, I come to you as humble as I know how, asking you to forgive me for all the sins I've committed in word, thought, act, or deed. I thank you, Lord, for coming into my life and live your life in me and allow me to live the way you will have me to live. Give me the will and the ability to live as you will have me to live. In the name of Jesus, and I will make you my Lord and my Savior for eternity. In the name of Jesus, amen. So if you join me in our salvation prayer, find a faith-based church and be baptized in the name of Jesus, and this will ensure you a spot in the heavenly kingdom. Complete the whole scenario. Not just they say the salvation prayer, but be baptized in the name of Jesus. Hello, I'm Veronica Brown, and welcome to Reflections. We're going to talk about Miriam, plagued by jealousy. Miriam was the daughter of Aram and Jochebed, and the sister of Aaron and Moses. Bible scholars assume her to be the sister mentioned in Exodus 2, who washed the basket that helped baby Moses float through the weeds to the Pharaoh's palace. Miriam watched from afar as Pharaoh's daughter retrieved the basket and claimed Moses as her son. Miriam offered to get a wet nurse, the child's own mother, unbeknownst to the Pharaoh's daughter. Years later, Moses fled Egypt and settled in Midian. He met Zippor, the daughter of Jethro, a Midianite priest, and married her. And you can read that also in Exodus 2, 15 and 24. Sometimes later, Miriam and Aaron criticized Moses because of his Cushite wife. We are not certain if Zippor is to be identified as this woman that Miriam and Aaron spoke against. It is possible, though not necessarily so, that the Cushite wife mentioned here was another woman Moses had married. In addition to their criticism related to Moses' wife, Miriam and Aaron questioned and challenged Moses' sole right to speak for God to the people. As a result of opposing Moses, which stemmed from jealousy, Miriam was stricken with leprosy. And you can read that in Numbers 12, 9 through 10. After Moses and Aaron interceded with God on Miriam's behalf, she was healed of her leprosy after a 7-day confinement. And that's also in Numbers 12, 11 through 15. The spirit of Miriam is alive and well in many women today. We daily suffer physical and spiritual calamities as a result of the deeply rooted jealousies that we harbor. It is jealousy that creates criticism and envy of our friends, loved ones, and even strangers. You don't even know. Jealousy and the actions that results from it are not of God, guys. Just not from God. So then, how do we warp or control jealousy? How do we prevent ourselves from suffering's Miriam plight? We must be reborn each day, seeking God in our every thought and action. We need to pray to him for strength to be spirit-minded, Christ-centered, and God-directed in our homes, workplace, communities, and most of all, in our churches. Do you sometimes struggle with jealousy and criticism? Ask God to relieve you. Receive glory from your life as he deals with you. Read Exodus 2, 4 and 10, 15, 20 and 21, Numbers 12, 1 and 16, 21 and 26, 59. Deuteronomy 24:9, and Malachi 6:4. And that brings us to the conclusion of Miriam today.
Reflections with Veronica Brown will return after these messages.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
Just kids, hungry, homeless, and vulnerable. Tragically, abused kids often feel safer on the street than they do at home. Right now, that's the most dangerous place of all. Covenant House is rescuing kids, but the need is overwhelming, and no child is ever turned away. Please, call or go online now with your gift of $19 a month to help a homeless child. You'll provide safe shelter, hot meals, and urgent medical care. You'll show our kids how much they're loved.
You want to know that there's somewhere you can go that's safe. So the Covenant House did that for us.
To have an environment, a whole building of people that say, hey, we love you. Hey, you're going to get through this. Hey, we got you.
Please call now With your gift of $19 a month, we'll send you this soft blanket to remind you of the comfort and hope you're providing to our kids.
I think about Covenant House every day because without Covenant House, like, where would I be?
Homeless kids are afraid and alone. Don't wait. Your gift is the lifeline a child needs. Please call or go online to safeplacetosleep.org now. Thank you for saving precious lives.
From the time John the Baptist began preaching until now, the kingdom of heaven has been forcefully advancing, and violent people are attacking it. And that's in Matthew 11:12. Ever since the time of John the Baptist, the kingdom of God has suffered violence. It becomes a reality through violence, persecution, and suffering. Wow. Therefore, only those who approach the kingdom in earnest and with dedication will inherit it. This scripture could also have been a warning of the persecution and violence still to come, and a challenge to prove that dedication to the kingdom is mightier than the violence against it. It does seem quite strange that we read in verse 13 that all the prophets and the law prophesied up until John, but this was the law declaring that the voice of prophecy would never be silenced. Thus it is written, the Lord your God will rise up for you a prophet like me from among your fellow Israelites. You must listen to him. And again, in verse 18, I will raise up a prophet like you from among their fellow Israelites. The reason why the Orthodox Jews hated Jesus was because, according to them, Jesus broke the law. And yet, both the law and the prophets referred to Jesus. God can send his messenger, and people can still refuse to acknowledge him. God can send his truth, and people can refuse to take notice of them. God's revelation is powerless without humankind's response. This is why Jesus ends this conversation with the words, anyone who's willing to hear should listen and understand. Sydney Smith stated, it is always right that a man should be able to render a reason for the faith that is within him.
I had somebody ask me if I caught the PTSD, like the flu. Did I what? Did I catch the PTSD?
There's no way that the military has females on the front line. There's no way that you, as small as you are, were able to shoot a 50 cal.
Yo, I did.
Every day, all day, and was pretty good at it, too.
When I'm wearing my little pink USMC veteran hat and someone says, so how did you serve? I said, well, I was a Marine. Oh, wow. You don't look like a Marine.
A veteran is someone who served. A veteran looks like me.
Humor is one way of just coping with stress. It's a release.
I got this backpack, and inside this backpack, a couple pairs of t-shirts, a pair of shorts, a couple pairs of underwear, some socks, which luckily now last me twice as long as you folks. It's okay to laugh if the one-legged dude is telling the one-legged jokes.
Shaving one eyebrow off while the soldier's asleep and he wakes up only have one eyebrow, that was humor.
If you can laugh about things, then you can take away some of the seriousness that's there.
There's a such thing as invisible wounds. They don't see me as a disabled veteran because I have all my limbs.
Traumatic brain injury, post-traumatic stress, whatever that might be, and you can't see them. They look fully functioning, but they're severely injured.
Post-traumatic stress is an isolator.
post-traumatic stress, it's kind of stigmatized. It isn't something that just happens in war. It's something that happens when you get put in an extreme circumstance. It's a human experience.
The biggest thing that people think is that we're all angry, that we're always mad about something, or that you can't ask us a question because we'll freak out.
You end up living with that for a long time, that survivor's guilt. What if I'd just been paying a little bit closer attention? Could I have seen something? They come up to you and they shake your head. They thank you for your service and they call you a hero. And you're like, heroes don't get people killed.
When I started talking to the Wonder Warrior Project, if I say my life fell apart, they kind of like gave me like the plans to figure out so I could put it back together.
21, 22 veterans a day committing suicide is just a little too much for me. And nobody should have to lose their life from war after they've come home from war. There's a lot of people that feel alone. I need to step up and make other people not feel alone.
So very reckless, dangerous, more disgusting. In public, you flexing, and still got life in your body. But count your blessings. Cause I got plenty of reasons to get my praise on. Looking back, can't really see where he done did wrong. Many people complain about a lot of things, but I just stick to my word. Shout out to King James.
God's always been there for me, even though I couldn't see.
I'm so glad he worked it all out.
story of Hagar. Battered, beaten, and rejected, but not abandoned. Given Hagar's story, it's no surprise that women of color find a kindred spirit in the person of Hagar. She was a young slave from Egypt who found herself in the midst of a foreign people. Hagar was forced to give her body to her master Abram, an idea proposed by his wife Sarah. And that's in Genesis 16:1-3. But once she obeyed her mistress and mastered, Hagar was rejected and scorned. Sarah's mistreatment of the pregnant Hagar forced the young woman to run away. Hagar fled into the desert where she met the angel of God. He told her to return to Sarah and give birth to Abram's son, Ishmael, who would become the father of a nation. Hagar was amazed that the living God saw her. Filled with hope, Hagar returned and gave birth to her son Ishmael. You can read this in Genesis 16:4-15. God is El Rohi, the God who sees me. God watches over everyone through eyes of love, grace, and compassion to guide people in their unique destiny. You can also read this in Genesis 21:1-7. In God's time and by God's grace, their promised son, Isaac, was born to Sarah and Abram, whose name was changed to Sarah and Abraham by God before Isaac's birth. After Isaac's birth, Sarah saw Hagar's child as a threat to Isaac's position as their heir, so she implored Abraham to expel them from their community. You can find this in Genesis 21:8-13. Hagar and Ishmael were sent into the desert with a small supply of food and water. When the water ran out, Hagar set apart from her son so as to not witness his death. Once again, the angel of God appeared to reassure her and to reveal to her a well of drinking water. Refreshed, renewed, and redirected, Hagar raised her son alone. Ishmael grew to be a strong, powerful man and founder of the Arab nations. Now remember, God is always watching us. And you can also read this in Genesis 21:14-21 and 25:13-18. Disadvantaged and depressed women today can relate to Hagar. Many have experienced estrangement, prejudice, hardship, hopelessness, grief, and despair. Many have known the fear that accompanies being an abandoned pregnant woman abused in this world. regardless of your circumstances, your social status, or how many times you've been knocked down, battered, and beaten by life, you cannot escape God's care. God provides for Hagar and her son Ishmael, and he can and will provide for you. Let me tell you this story. When I first moved to Minnesota, I just found a little job in a department store, and it just wasn't bringing in enough money. And we was really trying to find our way, but yet God was watching us. He sees everyone needs. So it happened that we happened to run into a home that was vacant, and the owner said, I'm trying to get rid of this home. And there was the man said, I want to give it to you. Now, is God watching? He was watching over my family. He was watching over me. He knew what our needs were, and he literally supplied it. Now, I had no idea where this money was going to come from to buy a house, because at the time, we was living in an apartment. The man just showed up at the house at the time we was there and said he wanted to sell us his home. And we told him we wasn't financially able to afford this home at this moment. But the man said, no, I'm gonna get this home to you until you get financially settled. God gave us a beautiful home in Minnetonka, Minnesota, until we got on our feet. And once we moved into the home, we were trying to figure out, you know, another job or how we're going to feed the children. God provided. Our neighbors came over to welcome us into the community. They was bringing all sorts of food, all type of food. God supplied all of our needs. So don't tell me that God did not watch us. He watches over his children for whatever your needs may be. May God hear you when you call. May God lift you if you fall. May God bless you as you stand. And may God hold you in the palm of his hand. May God bless you. You, yes. Even you.